Terry, thanks for joining us.
My
first question is, we always hear youth development and academies, and the class of 92 obviously made the headlines, but when I was researching with us here and you look at the players that came through Wolves, there's a fair few of Premier League players that have been produced through there that Wolves haven't got the credit for. So wanted to ask you first and foremost, what was the secret to getting those players from the youth level through to first team football?
I don't think there's any secret to it. Obviously, you need a good recruitment and good player identification systems in place. And I know the time that I joined in 1999, when I joined Wolves from Bristol City, you know, there was very good recruitment. And bearing in mind that we have clubs like Aston Villa, obviously we work in the Midlands, so teams like Aston Villa, Birmingham, West Brom, you know, Stoke, Leicester, you know, they're all around the Midlands, all looking for very similar players, local players. So you need to be very good with your recruitment and your identification of those players, and also with the coaching setup that you have in place. I think in 1999 when I joined, I think the feeling at the club was the youth team would win the league and win cups and Midlands Cups and everything and do well in the FA Youth Cup, but it didn't really translate to the amount of players that were getting through to the first team. And I'd worked with John Ward, who was the assistant manager at the time, to Colin Lee at Bristol City, and been quite successful there. And he felt that I would be ideal for the role of the third coach. So rather than just being a coach after the youth team and like a reserve team, I was actually called a development coach. And my remit, if you like, was to take those players from 18 years old, coming out of the youth setup and academy setup, and try and get them ready, if you like, for what would be first team duty, and see if we could bridge that gap between good young players that were obviously coming out of the youth team and getting them to play in the Wolves' actual first team, which, when you look back, wasn't easy. So Jack was the chairman at the time. He was always craving Premier League football, and at the time would pay for players, would buy players in, and it made it even harder, if you like, for the young players at the time to try and break through into the first team.
Robbie Keane was just coming through when you arrived then. I mean, how much of him was developed in Robbie when he got there? Did you hear? How much of it was just an anomaly of a talent?
Listen, Robbie, I had nothing to do with Robbie. Robbie came, I was aware of him from the year before when he broke into the first team. But I think we had Robbie, I joined in July, and Robbie left for Coventry, I think, that, in the October of that same season. He'd already proved he was an outstanding talent. Everyone knew that. He was just one of those stellar players that could do things that you just wouldn't try and coach. He could just do things that no one else could do. And it was quite obvious from looking at him in training that he was destined to play at the very top level of football. And within 3 months, Coventry had paid £6 million for him and took him as a 17-year-old, I think he was at the time. 17, would have been maybe 18. Coventry paid that for him to play what would have been the Premier League, in the top division. And after that, he went off and you know, just absolutely was a world-class player. But one of those things that happens out of the blue, things just click, things just happen, and you just find that gem that doesn't need coaching, if you like. He's going to be a very, very top player. So Robbie and I only worked together at Wolves for a pre-season and 3 months into the season. I think, recollection, he scored about 6 goals between that start of the season and that October. And I think it was Gordon Strachan. Might be wrong, but I think it might have been Gordon Strachan paid £6 million to take him to Coventry. You could see that he was destined But he had there were lots of other good players that were around at the time that needed developing and needed the help, if you like, of a coach and an environment created that would help them fulfill their talent. And whilst they're not all going to go on and be Robbie Keane's, I felt it was very important. What I tried to instill in them was that it would be there would definitely be their path. I wasn't trying to make them Robbie Keane. I wasn't trying to make them something that they weren't. But I wanted them to fulfil the potential that they obviously had for being at Wolves at that time. So it didn't matter to me whether they became top Premiership players. If their level was Championship or was League One and they played 900 games for one club and they were a stalwart for that, that would have been their level. That's what have been their abilities would have worked to. And all I asked for them was to work hard and to do everything in their power to achieve the very best that they could be as a footballer. If they did that, I was more than happy. And I've got lots of those lads still ring now, still talk to me now on the phone, and they still talk about things that we did way back in 99, 2000, 2001, 2002, 2003. And they still talk about the lessons that I tried to instill in them. And they're now moving into coaching. They're now doing other things, but they almost stand by the lessons that I was trying to give them when they were trying to bridge that gap between being a good young footballer and trying to make the grade to be known as a professional footballer.
When they do break through into this, you know, that it's a small gap, just an 18, 19 year old that breaks into the first team, but it's a life changer, not just in terms of the, I suppose, exposure they're getting day to day media, etc., but also they're probably going to start getting a big, big pay packet. And I mean, how do you keep a talented 19, 20 year old who's just broke in? How do you keep that player grounded and hungry?
I think by the lessons you instill in them on the training pitch and in and around the football club, it's creating that environment that they feel comfortable in. Most of the players I know and have gone on to be good players, yes, of course, everyone's going to want their wage packets and stuff and that, but the most important thing for me was for them to recognise that what they wanted to do, what the opportunity they had at that time was to be a top player, to be the best player they could. All the other things were incidental, the wage packet, the fast car, you know, the five-bedroom detached house and that. That would all come if they could reach their level of potential and smash through that. So it was always trying to keep them grounded, keep them focused on what the next goal was, which was obviously to improve as a player year on, year on, and make sure that they made the most of their abilities.
Brilliant. Fascinated by head coach, assistant coach relationships that have stayed together a long time. I was over with a Blackburn there a couple of months ago when Tony Mowbray was talking about him, his assistant, whose name has escaped me.
Tony Mowbray and Mark Venus.
Mark Venus. And they were so, he was just talking me through the whole relationship and they were so different. But they'd, you know, it was like an old married couple kind of thing. How did the relationship between you and Mick McCarthy work?
I could tell you, yeah. Well, it does work. He's always the boss. And I'm sure Tony and Mark are the same, that there's one boss in that relationship and he is the boss. Just like you say about the two, about Tony and Mark being like an old married couple. It is a bit like that. It's a bit of, I look at Mick and everyone looks at Mick and they can see a 6'2", silver haired, you know, real tough looking guy. And his assistant is about 5'7", 5'7½", black. But we both were born within probably 20, 25 miles of each other in Yorkshire. And I think it's the values that we hold and the way that we approach our work that make us understand each other, but also be very different in how we actually go about our, if you like, our daily work They say the gaffer is the gaffer, so he will give messages and speak to a group. And I feel, and I'm sure Mark's the same, that having heard that message, it's our duty then to get around the players, get around the group, get around the club, and make sure all the things that the gaffer has said in an overall is actually detailed, and people know exactly what he might have meant by saying something that they might not have known or understood. It's our job to make sure that they get that understanding and therefore all buy into that one target or one goal for the club. And I've always tried to do that for whichever manager I've worked for. I've always tried to be loyal and trustful. But as I say, with the gaffer and myself, I think the core values of what we look for in players and in teams and in each other are so similar, although the way we put things across are so very, very different in how we approach the same task. But don't get me wrong, you know, just like Mark and Tony, any good combination, I think, there are times where we question each other. You know, I have to question the gaffer, but we all know he's the gaffer. And once he speaks, once it's out in public, there's no way in the world that a good assistant would then undermine whatever the manager said. Although we may have spoken in the dressing room, we may have spoken in an office, but once we've made a decision, we've made a decision.
Brings us along nicely about decisions to the 2009 season. And I'll always remember this, that Sky News blew up with Sky Sports News about you had a big win on the Saturday and you went to Old Trafford and you rested, I think it was 10 players. I wanted to get your insight on basically, you know, was that an easy decision to make? Like, was it long term, or was, because there was a fair bit of noise in the media, was it tough for a few days around the club?
Not so much around the club. Obviously, we would have had disappointed players that wanted to perhaps play at Old Trafford and stuff and that. But if I can try and I try and remember correctly, if I'm wrong, then obviously correct what I'm saying. But that win on the Saturday, I think, was Tottenham away 1-0, and we had to work our proverbial nuts off to get that result. And we came in on the Sunday for a warm down, and as usual, I would dip around the dressing room and nip down the medical room and try and get a feel of how people are and, you know, how they're feeling when knowing that there's a game on the Tuesday night. And normally some of the lads will be like, you know, yeah, I'm okay, TC. I got knocked, but I'm fine. Don't worry about me. Tell the gaffer I'm fine. Saturday, I'm okay. Don't worry. But as I went round, it was obvious that the game had taken a lot out of the players. And, you know, they were very, very sore, very stiff. And, you know, a few that would normally say, I'm ready to go Tuesday, were like, well, I might need an extra day recovery and things like that. So all the feedback the gaffer got from myself, from the medical people, from the players themselves, was like, well, we're going to have to make some changes. We can't go into Man United with, you know, the same team. And as we sort of like went through it, went, well, we shouldn't play him because he's definitely going to struggle and he won't get through. And we went through actually 6 or 7 players that we felt we're going to have to, just because of the workload that we were going to have to go through, was going to be too much for them. So, you know, the gaffer said, well, we've talked about 7. Why not change the players and give the squad players their game at Man United, knowing that we had Burnley, I think, on the Sunday at home. So for us, you know, at that time, in the first season of the Premier League, I think, to get 3 points out of Tottenham would be like counting sort of like 5 points or 7 points out of that game to win a game like that away from home. But the most important thing would have been to win again at home against Burnley, who would have been there and there, you know, round about us near that bottom 6 of the table. So it was imperative that we won that game as well. So it became very much a no-brainer for the gaffer and myself to say, well, yeah, gaffer, if you want to rest the players and give them a chance to recover and train properly and prepare properly for the next game in the Premier League, then we're going to have to make those changes. So once again, once it was said and we discussed it and talked about it, it was that's what we're going to do. At the time, the bigger clubs, you know, the bigger size clubs, and that were making lots of changes for the Carling Cup or the Milk Cup or whatever it was called at the time. But they were big clubs, and I think that all the noise from the media came because it wasn't one of the big top four clubs that was resting, you know, 8, 9, 10 players. It was actually one that was working in the bottom six of the league. And obviously, we lost a game at Man United. And I remember, our fans sort of like singing, you know, we paid 40 quid to watch our reserves. And but always in our mind. And the gaffer took a lot of, obviously, took the criticism from Sky and from even around our club for taking that game on and losing 3-0. But nobody said a word when Sunday, when the lads were fresh, ready to play against Burnley and beat them 2-0. And at the end of the season, we stayed in the Premier League, I think it was by about 2 or 3 points. And it would have been that decision the gaffer made as a manager on the Sunday, Monday of that week, which made us stay in the Premier League. And that's the decisions, you know, managers paid to do. And he made it, and we did it, we stuck by it, and we went through the week, which was, you know, not the best. But on the Sunday, the lads were ready to go out and play again and beat Burnley 2-0.
Brilliant. Whenever you took the role as a head coach and you're in a relegation fight, and it's obviously there's half the season or 3/4 of the season played, what's the starting point as a manager when you go in? Like, how much can you actually change, or what are you trying to impact on the first week or two?
I think, you know, when managers take over and there's change at the top, it's never for a good, it's never at a good time. But I will say that when Mick lost his job at Wolves, both our bags were packed. So if the gaffer was going, you know, I was due to go with him. I was his assistant, and I'm due to go with him. If he leaves, I leave. And I think, well, I know the club didn't have a successor ready. And if I give you a bit of background context, we'd actually been beaten by West Brom on the Saturday, and Gaffer lost his job on the Monday. We lost 5-1 to West Brom. And obviously the fans weren't very happy, but we still weren't in the bottom three at that time. I think we were still just out of the bottom three. And they changed Mick, and they were changing me as well, but didn't have their successor in place. And whatever happened at boardroom level or whatever, higher than me, that didn't take place. So I was asked to stay and work for the next few days, take training, just look after the lads until the new guy would come in. And then obviously I'd say goodbye, and that was it. That turned from a few days into a week. It was international week, so the players were given a couple of days off, and well, take a long weekend off. When you come back, the new guy was ready to start. That didn't happen, and it became obvious that with only, I think it was 13 games to go over that season, the managers or the managers that they were approaching were not really looking to take the job for 13 games. They would want any manager worth their salt would be saying, well, I want, you know, my 2-3 year contract or whatever, so I can start rebuilding. So when, in my experience, it was one of those things. I was a few days, then it was a few days, and it was, could you prepare them for the Newcastle game in the following week? And I started preparations for them. But the lads know me. The lads have known me. I'd been there for 12, 13 years at the time. So all the players knew me, knew what my role was, knew what I did for Mick. So for me to go in there and say, right, what we've been doing for the last, you know, 3, 4, 5 years, that's a load of rubbish. Let's rip that up. Let's go and do this, and let's go and play like this, and everyone's going to do this, and it's going to be great. It was never going to be that scenario. The players knew how I worked, knew what I did, and I tried to keep things as right as possible. Because, in my opinion, I didn't think Mick and myself were far wrong as a duo. So I wasn't going to suddenly rip up and start again. So in that instance, I did it the way I tried to keep continuity in what we did in training, how we approached the games, in the formation of the team, because that's what the players understood would give them the best possible chance of, if they were going to beat the drop, it was going to be by doing the things that they knew and not something brand new. But I understand that other managers going into jobs with a 3-4 year contract or whatever can go in there and immediately start to reshape the club and do things that they want to put in place almost immediately and change the style of play, look at changing players, look at changing things in the dining room and all the things that a manager would want to put right and put his stamp on. They could do that, but it would not have worked in 2012, and it would not have worked when Mick left. You know, if Mick and I were working together and we were, you know, in the bottom six of the Premiership, which is where we were, but still I had our heads above water, it was a big ask to ask only half of that duo to finish off that job for the 13 games and do something completely different to what they were doing.
Okay, very good, very interesting. Last couple now, and then I'll turn it over to Enda. When you work at an international level, and you mentioned about you and Mick having the processes in place and probably a template that you're taking from club to club and being familiar with roles. And when you get to international football, and does training change because you've got more time to prepare for the upcoming game? Is there more tactical sessions, or did you change and tweak much of that there processes before the games?
No, the sessions were more or less the same, but specific to what we wanted from them. But there had to be, we were almost on stopwatch. If you can imagine getting all the players on a Sunday and you have a game on the Thursday or whatever, you've only got so many sessions, or maybe only one or two sessions that you can have all the players available for. They'll all be carrying their knocks and their aches and pains on a Sunday when they arrive. So Monday has to be very, very light. So you may only have Tuesday and then Wednesday's day, sometimes travelling day or day before a game. And so you're having to only have a limited amount of sessions and a limited amount of time with the players. So it was very important that we were very specific with the sessions, very specific. And the good thing about international football, or the thing I recognised straight away, was that we had the best goalkeeper, we had the best right back or left back, or we had the best centre halves that Ireland could provide for us. So we knew we had the best players, and when we spoke to them, they understood directly what we wanted from them. And in training, we kept things as simple as possible for them, so they knew their roles in those sessions. So we did the sessions, and we tried to then to obviously watch the session back, and then give the players almost immediate feedback on the session itself. So what we saw in the session, if we thought that was good, we would say, ah, great, that's what we're looking for. If it wasn't quite what we needed, we would go, look, maybe tomorrow we can have 5 minutes doing this, but I really need you to do this, or you need to try and do that. So it's almost like an instant thing, but it's very condensed and it's very intense in the time that you're there, because you only have so many sessions before you can actually play the game.
Then, of course, working with Robbie Keane, like circle of life in football, then with him coming around and starting his coaching journey, what advice were you giving him?
Robbie's a footballing icon. He, you know, he's a world class footballer. He's met and worked with a lot of stellar coaches, top coaches, top players. Worked with. He'll have lots. He has lots of his own ideas. He has lots of his own style of how he would like to work. And he's working on a day-to-day basis at Middlesbrough. He's also had the gaffer and myself, he's also seen us work for 18 months. The gaffer, I think, gave him his debut way back then for Republic of Ireland. So he knows us. He knows how we work and what we try to do. But Robbie is his own man. And as I say, he will have met top coaches, top players who's played alongside, and he'll have his own ideas. And all we can do is hopefully he's taken the right chemistry, if you like, and instills that in his teams, And if he does that and he is as half as successful or a quarter of his playing career, then he'll be a very successful coach.
Brilliant. Brilliant. Top class. Thank you, Terry. That was first class. Enjoyed that.
Thank you.
I'll bring Enda on here. Enda, are you there?
Yeah, here, boys.
All right.
Terry, how was it different for you going from club management into the international side with Ireland, like as regards the preparation, the time, you know, obviously contact with the players? Like, was that a big challenge for you, you know, having spent most of all of your managerial career in the club side?
Big challenge and really daunting. And I was really grateful that obviously Gaffer had been there and done it before, so he was able to say, look, don't worry too much, just do what you do what TC does. But it was a big change. Obviously, not out on the grass on a daily basis with the players was always a real big concern for me.
Yeah.
But it did give me more time to study the players, to get around the country and watch the players. I knew quite a few of them from, obviously, coaching and management in the Championship and Premiership, so I knew some of the players firsthand, if you like. And so I would just try my best to get round to watch them all. And I did try, when we got into camp, to have something that I could speak to them about their performances at their clubs or whatever, that I thought was good or thought, you know, would be helpful when they got into the Irish setup. And that would, I'd be saying to them, no, that was great. I saw that last week or saw that 2 weeks ago. Saw you do that. Thought that was excellent. Gaffer would really like that if you can bring that to the party sort of thing. So I think they felt, well, I was able to build a relationship with them because I think they felt that I'd almost like gone out my way, if you like, to make contact and to have a relationship with them other than just taking them out on the training pitch.
Yeah. Wolves has always, or in the past, had a really strong tradition of recruiting Irish players when Mick was there. What was the attraction, Terry, like to recruiting Irish players into the academy and obviously into the first team? Like, what do you know was the attraction, obviously, to Irish players for Mick?
I know that if you, I'm not saying they're cheap, but I'm saying that a player who you have to buy from, you know, maybe from another English club,
yeah,
would cost you a lot more money. This a similar young player would cost you a lot more money, and also the fact that there are good players in Ireland. You know, we both used to go across and watch the Irish League because there's good players in there,
yeah.
And you know that they come with good reputations, and it's just giving them, I think, the environment and confidence to go on and the belief to go on and make a move from Ireland. Yeah. And we had a good recruiting and scouting network. We used to work a lot with Willie Burns, who I don't know if you know, but was around the, you know, around the Dublin and around the scene, and he was very good at recruiting, letting us know about players. And the players themselves, I feel that, you know, the Irish players have a certain tradition about them, certain way about them. They work very hard. They want the team to do well. There's certain traits that they put before themselves, if you see what I mean, as players. Yeah. And I think that's why they do, you know, the Irish players do so well and Irish teams do so well, because whatever they may be deficient in maybe skill or technical ability, they certainly make up for with their group mentality. And I think Gaffer's very big on that the group is the group wins, the team wins. And we certainly felt that with recruiting Irish players, that we would definitely have that in their character.
Brilliant. Preparation for games, Terry. How much would you use data and analysis and you know, or, you know, are you open to using it more? Is it something you enjoy? Like, you know, just talk us through kind of how you would use it in preparation, or is it something that you're a big fan of, or how does that work for you?
Okay, I think I'm one of those. I'm a big fan, but I have no idea. So you getting me on today to use my my tablet here to get them. That's a challenge. But Obviously, you need to know, you need to study the opposition, you need to study your own players. And as much as you're on the training pitch and working on the training pitch, there's so much more you can learn from replays and watching things back. So it is a big, big part of the game is analysis. And we were very lucky, particularly when we joined the international setup, that we had people like Jay Dunn, who were exceptional in almost reading our minds and knowing what we would need for footage and stuff and that, and having that ready for us. So he actually limited the amount of time that we'd have to troll through things or look through things. But we're a big fan. We like to use it for our own benefit, but also in preparation of the opposition. You must and should always study what the opposition are doing, what their strengths and weaknesses are, and your job or your role really is to try and nullify their strengths and then try and attack their weaknesses and impose yourselves on them. And certainly analysis and your preparation that you can have both on the pitch and in a classroom, if you like, environment should go hand in hand, I think, if you want to be successful.
Yeah, brilliant. Tell us about your time with Ireland, Terry. Obviously, how was your experience? Passionate nation with the fans and the people and just all your experiences working with the Irish team. And was it hard, like, going into it as well, like, knowing that, you know, you wouldn't be there, in 5 years? You know, you knew it was a short-term kind of deal. And,
Only won every game.
So how did you enjoy it? How was it, the Irish experience? How was it for you?
As I said to the gaffer, it was an absolute, it was an honour and a privilege to be asked to do it by the gaffer, to work alongside the gaffer for the Irish national team and for the FAI. I know what it means to the gaffer, and I know that he could have, there was hundreds of candidates that he could have chosen to be his assistant to work at international level. And he chose me, so I was honoured, and it was a privilege to serve the Irish nation. I had nothing but great feeling from everybody I met, whether I went over towards Galway or down south or whatever. Everywhere we travelled, they were only giving us their best wishes. And as I said, the players came and they gave everything for us. And the support staff, the medical staff, the security team, everyone surrounding the international setup whilst I was there was absolutely first class. And we're just sorry that we couldn't get didn't get the opportunity to get to the 2020s with automatic qualification, and we're not able to take that through to the playoffs.
Yeah, great stuff, Terry. So a big buzzword these days, obviously, is culture within the dressing rooms. What would be a dressing room that you've coached in, managed in, played in, that was just an unbelievable culture, obviously from your time playing or managing?
I think you try to create that everywhere you go. As a player, You get on with your teammates. You've got an instant group of players that you get on with, and maybe some more than others. But when you're coaching and managing, you realise the importance of having everyone, dialed into the same goals. Not only players, but you also want all your staff to be committed and see the goal and the target that you're aiming for. And so it became more graphic and more important to me that everyone buys into the team ethic and the work ethic that you want from a team, and I think wherever we've been, certainly the gaffer and myself, we've always tried to put that. We've always put that first. That the team and the dressing room must be united, but there must be a bond between the tea lady, the chef, the MD, whoever it is. We all should be looking at the same goal, not just the players, but everybody, everyone connected with it. We try to bring with us and take with us and say, look, we're all in this together, whether you're the boss or whether you're the tea lady or, the guy that washes the boots or whatever it is, your role is important to us. And if we all do our jobs properly and we all link in together, there's much more chance of us being successful as a group.
Brilliant. Over the years, Terry, man management, how do you think it's changed over the last 15, 20 years in managing players, and has it made you adjust your styles along the way, or have you seen that change?
Yes, I think if I'm honest, managers like Mick are becoming less and less. I think they're looking more for head coaches, but dealing with players is different, and I think that's again down to a number of factors. They certainly, years back, it was the manager first and the players played. Now the players, I think, have more say. They have a bit more of a voice, or a lot more of a voice, and you must take that into consideration. So, yes, over the years, the players will tell you, those that were with me in the early years and see me work now will say, oh, there's been a mellowing from TC. But I think it's just the mellowing has come from the fact that society means, you can't deal with people, or you can't say the things that you may have said maybe 20, 25 years ago are not going to be acceptable or not going to be agreed with now. So again, we talk about technology and moving along with those things. There's also, management style has to change. Although I will always say that our ethos, the way that we want to work, our goals and everything remain the same. If someone steps out of line, they'll know about it. If someone doesn't do things at the right time, they'll know about it. But you probably can't deal with it in the same way you may have dealt with it in years gone by.
Absolutely. What challenges have you faced throughout your career, Terry? Going from, playing to coaching, and what challenges would stand out for you, and how did you overcome challenges that were thrown at you?
That might be a two-part question. Obviously, the challenges in football being able to get into someone's team and be valued as a player and become good enough to play. And like people say, if you get into 400, 500 games that you've played, then you've been a proper player, you've been a real player. So those challenges are always to be better than the guy next to you so you can play in the team and stuff. But obviously, I'm not going to shy away from the fact that obviously I am black, and particularly, when I was growing up in the late 70s and joining Leeds United in 79, obviously there were issues with race and colour, and those went through the 80s with us and through the 90s. And, thankfully now things have changed and for the better, and we're still trying to push forward with that. But there were challenges that, had to be taken on in those times if, as a black player, you wanted to play a professional football and play for teams like Leeds United and Brighton, Portsmouth. That there were certain things that you'd have to fight for and be aware of to make your progress in the game. But thankfully, things have certainly moved on, and in 2020 we're all in a better place because of it.
Yeah. Who was your role model, Terry? Growing up, or did you have a role model? Who did you look towards?
I didn't really have one. There was a player at Leeds called Albert Johansson, a South African player, and he played for Leeds United, and I always wanted to wear the white of Leeds United. But I also remember watching television, it would have been the early 70s, maybe 72, 73, where there was a player called Clyde Best who played for West Ham, and he played centre-forward, and he took a lot of stick, but he played used to play really well. I used to watch him on TV, and I knew that that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to go and play and be a player. So he was like the first person I saw on TV that I thought, I want to be like him. I want to play and be on the pitch like him. As I got older, players like Laurie Cunningham and Viv Anderson were breaking in and playing for top clubs. And a good friend of mine was passed away now, Cyril Regis. They were players that were playing for West Brom with Brendan Batson. And they were they were sort of like, if you like, my role models in terms of, well, if they can do it and they can play in the Football League, then, you know, there's nothing that's stopping me from doing it. So whatever challenges I had to face from there on, I was going to face them because I wanted to be just like those players that were playing for West Brom or Notts Forest in the Champions, or was a European Cup then, Champions League now. And when I wanted to be part of that, I wanted to try and be as good as I could be and take part in that environment. So those were my sort of like role models. And obviously, looking further afield, when you see World Cups in 1970, you see the Brazilian team and you see clips of Pelé and things on what they did, then you just know that, you know, they're at the very, very top and world-class players.
Yeah, brilliant. What words of advice would you give to a young coach that's coming up along, and you know, what words of wisdom would you throw their way, Terry?
I would say, and this is just my journey, so is that you have to be in it for the long haul. There's no quick fix. You have to do your work. You have to go and do your courses. You have to go through, for me, a process if you want to become a coach where people recognize you and value you for the work you've done. Then there has to be longevity to it. So it's a long road, and there's many ups and downs. You know, when I started out coaching, I was working what they call football in the community. We used to go into schools, and anybody would have youth clubs, anyone that would have us, girls schools, anybody, authorities that with people with disabilities and things like that, we would go into them and we would coach those kids. They were invited to, when I worked at Bristol Rovers, they were invited to games. And I remember my wife and I used to, we've got twins, three young children, but we had twins at the time with an elder daughter. And we used to have to push two trolleys around on a Friday, one for our own shopping and one for 70 to 100 kids to make sandwiches and sandwich boxes for those on the Saturday. And many a time we'd look at each other with, you know, three screaming kids and think, you know, why am I doing this? But eventually, you know, things, you get a break and you get a chance and you try and work hard at what you do and you try and fulfill the role that you're asked to do. And, you know, I was lucky enough to get a break. And as I said, that was in 94. And it's only probably the last, since I met Mick and worked with him at 2006, have I been an assistant manager. Before that, there were lots of roles, lots of hardship, lots of ups and downs, lots of rejections. But I knew that I wanted to make a career out of working with players, working as high as I could in the professional game. So you stick at it and you take your breaks when they come. And I was lucky enough that the gaffers saw something in me and made me his assistant manager. And we've been together since 2007. And I've been his assistant for the last 13, 14 years. But it's a long haul. So anyone who thinks it's just it's a job, you can just go and become assistant manager of the Republic of Ireland or of an Ipswich Town or a Wolverhampton Wanderers. You just think, oh, I can just do that because I can. It's a long, long, hard road and a long, long process. Or in my opinion and in my experience, that's what I've found. There's no quick fix.
Yeah, brilliant. Some experiences, Terry, on dealing with young players coming through to the first team. Like, how did you guys deal with younger lads coming through? And you know, do you have any experiences to share on that? Obviously, what's the key points in making sure the transition is good for them?
Belief in them. You know, they will believe that they can play in the first team and that. And as I said, there's a process that you have to go through. To understand what it is, you know, when you're playing youth football, when you're playing underage football, you win and it's fine. You win trophies and people, you know, yeah, you're great. But when you actually move into the league, where it's, you know, there's more than just a trophy. You know, there's people's wages and people depend on you doing your job. It's not just about you playing football as well as you can. You have to learn to be part of a group. part of a team that has a common goal. And it's keeping them focused. You know, I like to have individual players have individual targets that they feel that that they want to achieve, and check in with them. Check in. So even though they might be in the first team and playing well, there still might be things that you might need to be looking at and thinking, well, has he got this influence outside the game? Is he doing this right? Is his home life good? Is things, you know, going well for him off it as well as on it? What do we need to do to get in the team more often? Players like Keith Andrews, who was in my first year when I went to Wolves, and I'm sure he won't mind me saying this, he came and you know, he found things really tough at the start, and then we got him playing really well, and he was near getting towards that first team. But there was people like Paul Ince, there was Colin Cameron, Alex Ray, the three that I can name, it's probably another midfield player, there must have been four, that were ahead of him and played in the first team, and it was very difficult for Keith to break in. And he lost a bit of confidence, lost a bit of belief. If he could break in, he went out on loan, played some games. When he came back, he was more ready to challenge those players. Eventually, you know, the manager took the chance and put him in the team, and then he flourished. But it wasn't easy for him at the start. There was, you know, there's obviously there was mental issues where he was thinking, oh, am I ever going to be good enough? Am I ever going to get a chance? And we had to keep believing. He had to keep believing in himself. And it was my job to make sure that he kept believing in himself. He stayed on the right path. He did things that were going to be positive in getting him into the first team. And eventually he broke into the first team, played, went on to MK Dons, Blackburn in the Premier League, and became a Republic of Ireland player. But it was, it's to talk about full circle. That was my first meeting with Keith in 99, and now he's assistant to Stephen Kenny at international level. So it just shows you, if you know, things go full circle.
Yeah, brilliant. During your time with Ireland, obviously Jack Byrne from Shamrock Rovers was capped. How much of the League of Ireland did you see, Terry? I mean, obviously, you know, for me growing up in Ireland, always you kind of saw it in the news, the misconception was playing in the League of Ireland, you know, you wouldn't get a shot at the senior side. We've had a few over the years, but, you know, it was great to see Jack Byrne get in there. But how much did you watch of the League of Ireland, and you know, what was your thoughts there, like, of lads playing in the League of Ireland, you know, and getting their shot at national team level?
Okay, and I'll be honest with you here, because Jack Byrne got his cap and we're in the squads because of his ability to play football, not because he was a League of Ireland player. It was because of his ability to be in the squad and be part of a 23 or whatever, 23-man squad. I didn't watch a lot of Irish football because the our remit was to qualify or attempt to qualify for 2020. So we had to make sure that everything that we did for the next game. The next game, the players that would be available for the next game. Now, there's no disputing that, you know, the players that play in England play at high level, and they play consistently at a high level. So whether they're in the Premiership or whether in the Championship, the level of consistency that they have to reach to be an international player is very, very high. So our focus was to make sure that we had the best 23 there. But whenever Jack was playing or whatever, or whether we could get to the Republic of Ireland, get to Dublin to watch Jack, to be against one of another player, to have an opinion of him, we would make sure we went to see him and others that were recommended to us. But in our overall assessment and our overall judgment, we felt that the players that were going to represent Republic of Ireland through the 2020 campaign were going to come basically and mainly from Championship and Premier League teams.
So when you did get along, you enjoyed the foot. You know, it was good level. Were you surprised or?
Absolutely. I don't know what people will think of this, but there are good players that play in the Irish league.
Yeah, absolutely.
But there are, but the understanding is that if you come and play in the Championship, there's a more consistent level. So yeah. There's more good players. So the players have to raise their game every week, whereas Jack could be announced. Jack Byrne, for instance, could be an outstanding player for Shamrock Rovers, but he may only ever come up to a player of his own ability, maybe once or twice, maybe when he, if you play Dundalk or play one of the top teams, will someone be able to compete on his level? Whereas if Jack Byrne is playing in the Championship or in the Premiership in England, he will face that player every single game.
Yeah.
Every single game will be a test at a level that he has to achieve for everyone. So it's not just once in a while, it's every week that these players, and that's what you try to get across to, that the league is stronger purely because it has more players of a higher standing than in the Irish league. And that's just a fact. But there are good players playing in the Irish league, no question.
Yeah, for sure. All right, Terry, I'm going to pass you over to John here. Really thank you for your time. He's going to finish it off with you, but really enjoyed the chat.
No problem. Thank you, and thank you very much.
Cheers. Yeah, good man. Thanks, Terry. Cheers.
All right, Terry, I think I got two or three to finish it out.
Yeah.
What core values are you looking for in youth players?
I would say in all players. I like a strong mentality. I take for granted that they're good players. So I take for granted that they're going to be good players with a good technical ability. But we're looking for people that are going to be strong mentally and are going to be able to be consistent over a course of time.
Gotcha. I'll be remiss of me not to mention Leeds United. Back when you played there, when you made the breakthrough, who were the players that were there? And then obviously, who was the manager that gave you the breakthrough?
Okay, the manager and the assistant manager that gave me the breakthrough were Jimmy Adamson and Dave Merrington, who's his assistant. They were two real tough, thick people from the Geordie area, up north, and really strong characters, and instilled a lot of good values in me, those core values, those mental strengths, those abilities to keep going through tough times. That was one thing that they instilled on us, and some of the training that we did, and we ran through nettles and stuff like that just to test how hard we would be. But the players that were around, the biggest one just passed away, was the proper TC. That was Trevor Cherry. When I got to the club, he was club captain. And he had a lot of time for me, and he took me under his wing, and the things that I didn't know, and was, I was really green as grass, and things that I did, he helped me a lot in the games and told me where to be and what to do, and sometimes gave me a right good ticking off when I was trying fancy flicks and he wanted the ball held up to, so he could get a breather when he was defending, and he would say, you got to get hold of that ball, it's not about you flicking things and that. But he was a real leader, a real captain, and obviously it was devastating news when I heard earlier this week that he passed away.
Yeah,
but people like Trevor Cherry, they were big. People like Paul Hart, Arthur Graham, all really good professionals who knew the game and taught me, because I was in the team when I was 17, so I didn't spend much time in the youth team, and they taught me very, very quickly, the values of what to do and how to play the game to win and to win points and to get results on a Saturday or a Tuesday night.
Excellent. That's great stuff. Great insight, Terry. What's next for you, do you think?
I really don't know. It's one of those things, obviously it's a real shame that we couldn't do the playoff games for the Republic of Ireland. But I'm sure the gaffer and myself, we both feel that there's another challenge in there for us somewhere. hopefully it's not too distant future we can get back to work. Where it will be, we will never, we don't know. Last time we got in at Ipswich, the gaffer called me and said, listen, I've just taken a call from Ipswich, that's where we're going, meet me down there tomorrow morning and we'll start work, sort of thing. So you never quite know where it's going to be, but we do hope that we get a chance to manage again and try and be successful at a football club.
Brilliant. Well, you'd be happy to know Lewis didn't send in any questions or give us any insider information, so we're all set.
I was ready. That I was waiting for that.
Terry, thanks very much for your time. You've been very, very generous. You. Wish you and your family best of luck and stay safe.
Thank you very much for having me on, and I really appreciate it. Really appreciate it. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Top class, Terry. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Gary. Thank you, Ender. Thank you very much. Hope that was okay. Hope that's
brilliant, Terry. Thank you very much.
Folks, that's our fifth webinar wrapped up. Back again next week. Just look out for any information. Also for the NAI, American Coaches Association, North American. If you're interested in helping out, let us know and get with us. And we have some positions that need filling. Best of luck. Have a safe weekend. Take care. Thank you, Terry.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you very much.